Okay, now let's say you have this random sample x1 to xn drawn from this Gaussian mu sigma square. If you look into this quantity, x bar minus mu divided by sigma square 1, the claim is this is going to be Gaussian with mean 0 and variance 1, or this is going to be a normal distribution. Everybody agree with this? Okay, how to compute again? Again, just to do, go and do your moment generating function, calculate for this, and you will actually see that you will end up getting. Okay, one quick way to verify that this is indeed have a mean is like how to, what is the, if you compute this, can I write it as like this? Okay, because sigma square by a constant, I pulled it out, and expectation of x bar minus mu, and I know that expectation of x bar is mu, that's why it is 0. And in a similar way, you can also compute variance of x bar minus mu by sigma square by n, which is nothing but covariance of x bar mu . Agree with this? And now we know that this is nothing but 1 upon sigma square by n whole square covariance of x bar minus mu x bar minus mu, right? Now if you just expand this, you will see that this will actually turn out to be just 1. Okay, now first let's simplify, further break down the problem. Instead of assuming that both mu and sigma square are unknown, let's assume that sigma square is known. Okay, what is unknown is only the mean value is unknown. And now, if that's the case, can I understand from this value how much is the difference? Now only mu is unknown, and I want to quantify how much is the difference. I want to basically, let's say I want to ask this question whether this is going to be greater than epsilon, if I want to ask this question. Now what I know is, instead of this, what I will consider is, I will consider this quantity, which is nothing but x bar minus mu greater than epsilon sigma square by n. Now can I ask what is the probability that x bar minus mu is greater than epsilon sigma square by n? Can I compute this probability? Okay, what is that? Phi of? Okay, x bar. What is the distribution of x bar minus mu? Normal? Okay. Everybody agree? Now I can't directly use the phi function here, right? I need to do couple of more steps here. What are those couple of more steps? Okay, let's write here. This is nothing but probability that x bar minus mu greater than epsilon sigma square by n, and no, wait a minute. So what I want is this difference, I want it to be lying in this region outside, right? This difference, I want it to be exceeding some region. Let's write this. This x minus mu should be okay, let's say okay, maybe you should try it like this. Want this and this. Probability that x bar minus mu greater than epsilon sigma square by n plus probability that x bar minus mu less than minus epsilon sigma by square. Is this correct? I am just writing this part into these two probabilities. Like when this is positive quantity, it should be there. When it is negative, it should be equal to this. Okay, now what I know about this, I can further simplify this step. Okay, where I can write? Now this is nothing but 1 minus probability that x bar minus mu less than epsilon sigma square by n plus probability that x minus mu less than or equals to minus epsilon sigma square by n. And by our definition, what is this quantity? But notice that x minus mu, what is the distribution of x minus mu? And when I want to apply phi function, I want to make sure that the distribution of this quantity is normally distributed. So what I will do is, I think I should have avoided this circus. What should I have done is, I should have kept this x minus mu sigma square by n, this is less than epsilon, and plus probability that x minus mu sigma square by n less than minus epsilon. And now I know that this quantity is what? Normally distributed, right? So this is nothing but 1 minus phi of epsilon, right? And what is this other quantity? This is phi of minus epsilon, right? Now notice that this all I could do provided my sigma square is known. Now I know that, if I know that, now I am able to understand how much is my difference. Actually, there is one small caveat here, like the way I used. I am now basically asking my difference x bar minus mu to be greater than this quantity. Okay? Now I am, but this can be anything that is given to you. Suppose, let's say you have been asked x bar minus mu, let's say you want to find it, this value to be greater than gamma. Now all this, my method works if I set my gamma to be epsilon sigma square by n, and so actual sigma is gamma n by sigma square, right? So if I want to know that my difference is greater than gamma, then I should be writing this epsilon to be gamma n divided by sigma square. So this should be actually 1 minus gamma n by sigma square plus gamma minus gamma n by sigma square. Is that clear? Is clear? You wanted me to do more calculations. Is that fine? All these details? Okay, now, but unfortunately, many times we may not even know gamma square, right? Both mean and variance could be unknown. But in that case, I can't apply this directly. Okay, then what's the method for that? For that, we have a method which was proposed by one of the famous statistician long back, I think in early 1800s, G.S. Gossett. I don't know if it's 1800s or early 1900s, long back. Statistics is a very old subject. So, a lot of people have worked development in statistics has happened in early 1900s. So, a lot of these results are pretty old actually. But now if you see that, most of these results are now repackaged and now you see them as machine learning methods. Okay, when you do machine learning, actually you will be basically doing this. You will having data, trying to extract information from the data. Okay, now, when sigma square is n is known, you could do this and you got a normal distribution and that helped you to find out what is the error. Now, but when you don't know, I have to find some proxy for sigma square, right? What is a good proxy for sigma square? Sample variance. So that's what I will do is, instead of sigma square, I will go and put sample variance. I think, why is this? Did I make any mistake either? Should it be square root or? It should be square root, right? Everywhere. Everybody agree? It should have been square root of sigma square by n instead of square root by n. Now that is what now sigma square's proxy is s square, and when I put under square root, it becomes simply s by square root n. Now I am saying that, okay, I don't know sigma square, let's take its sample estimator and I'll put it like this. Now the resulting distribution of this, notice that x bar is a random variable, s is a random variable, so this whole quantity is a random variable. When these samples are coming from population which is Gaussian with mu sigma square, then this quantity x bar minus mu s by n has a distribution which is called student t distribution with n minus degrees of freedom. Now, what is that distribution? Now, let's try to find out actually what is the distribution of this quantity and how does this t distribution look like. Okay, we'll do some manipulation. This is the quantity of our interest, x bar minus mu divided by s by square root n. What I will do is, I will divide and multiply by sigma by square root n. Okay? If I do the sigma by square root n, you will get this expression. Notice that I don't know what is the actual value of sigma, but let's say that I could do this sigma by square root n. I have just done this. Now I am going to look into this as a ratio of two random variables. The numerator is this quantity and the denominator is this quantity. What is the purpose of doing it like this? Separating numerator and denominator. If you now notice, is the numerator is a quantity which I know. Right? Which is x bar minus mu sigma by x n square, which has a Gaussian distribution. And the denominator has this s square by sigma square. Suppose if I multiply it by n minus 1, I know that we just discussed that this has a chi square distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Right? So what I have basically done is, and also notice that we just discussed that this quantity and this quantity, they are independent of each other when it is Gaussian distributed, isn't it? So this quantity is just like this normalized version, centralized and normalized, and this was sigma square, s square by sigma square when we multiplied by n minus 1. We notice that this is a chi square distribution and these two are independent. So you have to be careful, like what we actually said is x square and s square are independent. Okay? But here we are saying this quantity u and this quantity v, they are independent. This needs little bit thinking, right? We know that s bar and s square are independent, but here x square is being subtracted by constant mu and normalized by sigma, whereas this quantity s square is also multiplied by constant n minus 1 by sigma square. So both this s square here by multiplied by constant and this x bar is also manipulated with some constant. If you just add and add some constant or multiply constants, does this change the independence nature? No, right? So that's what that's why we are doing this. Sigma is unknown, but you just take some sigma value. It is constant here. It's unknown, but in this computation, it's a constant. Okay? We are notice that I have written exactly sigma. I have not put it as an its estimator or something. So this is that constant only. Now, if you now look into this, this quantity here, nothing but in terms of our representation, numerator is simply u and the denominator is simply v by n minus 1. And this quantity and denominator, they are independent of each other. So this helps us to compute the distribution of this quantity, which we are calling as t distribution. Now if you use this property, now what we have, let's call our z. Z is our quantity of interest, which is mu by s by square root of n, which now we are able to write it as v u by v by n minus 1. So I can treat as now z as function of these two random variables u and v. And we know how to compute distribution of functions of random variables, right? If you recall all the methods that we studied earlier, where we use Jacobian and all, right, to find out the distribution of joint distributions, we can use that method here. And now if you do that, I'm jumping the step now, if you do that, you will actually end up the distribution of here I'm calling this as x, this is x, this x will have a t distribution denoted by tp, and it will end up with this kind of PDF function, and this is for all x between minus infinity to plus infinity, and this is exactly called TE distribution or denoted as TP with the p degrees of distribution. So when I say now henceforth my notation is when I write TP, This is a T distribution with P degrees of freedom. And as a special case, when I set P equals to 1, this will end up with this simple form, which has a special name called Cauchy distribution. Okay, now quickly, you may be wondering, how does this magically come up, this distribution? As I said, this comes from computing the joint distributions. Okay, so let's take, you have this U and V, and we know that U and V are independent, and we know the distribution of U. U is Gaussian distribution, and V is chi square distributed with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Since U and V are independent, I should be able to write their joint PDF, right? Just to take their product because of their independence. And now define two random variables, x like this, y like this, and then just to find the joint distribution of f of y in terms of the joint distribution of U and V. That we have done using Jacobian method earlier. And now you will see that after that you find out, after you find the joint distribution, you find the marginal, that will exactly give you what I have written here. Again, this needs to be verified. That's why this you need to check. Again, I will post you the book where these computations are done, but you need to go and verify that. It's very difficult, and not really difficult, it will be like, I don't want to sit out and work out all the details. This, all the details you already know. Okay?